Well, good morning, church, and happy Father's Day. It's great to be in the house of the Lord today, and to all of you fathers, I want to say thank you for your love, your care, your provision for your families. God ordained the family, and He ordained for fathers to be leading and loving and caring upon their families. I thank each and every one of you men for doing so. I also want to just challenge all of us fathers and men to be fathers of what the Bible says about being a father, because in our culture today, the view of a father is not the biblical view of a father. The Bible describes the father as the head of the home under the leadership of God as the head over man. And that means to be a wonderful father, you have to have the fear of the Lord. To be a wonderful father, you are under someone else's leadership. You're under God's leadership. And you lead your family according to God's word. You love your wife, as it says in Ephesians chapter 5. You cherish her. You sanctify her. And so, men, we are responsible for the physical and mental care to our wives, and we are responsible for the spiritual well-being of our wives. It is a tremendous responsibility to be a husband, and then on top of that, to be a father. To raise children under the lordship of Jesus Christ, under His word and His guidance and His direction. Our culture is looking for men that will lead in such a way. And so to all of you men leading in that way under the fear of the Lord, I say thank you. Continue to shine bright for Jesus. Continue to love and cherish your wives. Continue to raise your children that when they leave the home, they are grounded in the faith to stay true to the Lord and be fathers and mothers in their future families. To all the fathers in the room, I'm going to ask you to stand at this time. I'd like to pray a prayer over you. Let us pray. Lord God, I thank you for these men. I thank you for their love for you and love for their families. And I pray, God, you would fill them with your spirit, that you would lead them to have deep conviction about you and your word and to be unwavering in their faith. To lead their wives and their children as you lead them and as you lead all of us. Lord God, we know from your word that we don't determine right and wrong. You've already given it to us. And so, Lord God, help all the fathers to lead according to what you say is right. Lord God, allow us to realize the great privilege and blessing we have as fathers. And help us to never take it for granted. And I pray, Lord God, for those that will be future fathers, I pray that you would prepare them now for the responsibility and the privilege and high honor they will have to be a husband and a father. And I pray for those, Lord God, under the sound of my voice, that had a father that was not an extension of you, a father that does not provide good memories. I pray, Lord God, that you would let them know that you, Lord God the Father, are a good, good father. And that you love them beyond measure. And that when they look at how a father ought to be, they look to you to see your example of love and compassion and care, but also discipline and leading. Leadership, Lord. And so we thank you that you lead us, and we pray today as we gather in spirit and in truth that you would speak into our lives and make us the people you want us to be. We pray this all in the name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you, fathers. You may be seated. And this past week, if you don't know, it was a big week in the life of our church, Vacation Bible School. And so watch this video at this time.
Thank you. passion to share all that God can do. We'll be a witness to His power and His plan. We'll follow where He leads. Show love to those in need. He's calling us to be a light to every.
Got the bad end of that, but the boys and girls compete in a missions offering, and the girls won this year, so they were the ones that got to paint on the pastor. So over $3,300 was given to provide water filters in Guatemala. The Guatemala mission team is going to be going in November, and we're going to be able to help put in some of those water filters. A lot of the people there do not have running water. Can you imagine going home today and not being able to turn on a faucet to clean anything, to wash your hands, to take a shower, to wash clothes? There's no running water. And so these water filters are going to be an avenue to tell them of the living water of the Lord Jesus Christ. We're going to be able to do that. Over $3,300 was given. Those of you that participated in that along with the kids, thank you, thank you, thank you for investing what God's doing throughout the world. I also want to thank each and every one of you that volunteered and served in Vacation Bible School. It took hundreds of volunteers and servants to get it done this week. I say thank you to each and every one of you for sacrificing your time and energy to invest in the children. We had multiple conversions that are being followed up and counseled with for baptism in the days ahead. In addition, we had others that obviously were wayward and now are running right with the Lord due to this week. And so I want to just thank you for your work of service and labor of love. Also, if you're visiting with us here today, you might be someone that came this past week and you're here for the very first time. Thank you for being here. Know that we here at First Baptist love you, we care for you, and we are thrilled you are here, and we hope you'll just make this a habit and be with us week after week after week. And whether you are part of Vacation Bible School or not, if you're visiting with us today, we have a Connect card that should be in the seat near you, in front of you. You can get that and fill that out. You see it there on the screen. You can fill that out, and we have a Connect desk right out this way after the service. If you would take that Connect card there, we have a gift for you, and we want to be able to provide that gift for you to show our appreciation for you. If you don't want to fill out the card, you can text the word STEPS to 484848, and you can fill out the information on your phone as well. We would love to have your information so we can pray for you by name in the days ahead. Last we have two mission trips this year as a church. One is to Montana. The Montana mission team is there today. And so I think we have a picture of them. There they are. They are up in Montana helping the church plan up there. And so let's be mindful to pray for them, not only this morning, but each day this week as they are serving the Lord and being on mission in Montana. And so I'd like to go to the Lord in prayer and pray for them at this time, and then Pastor Tim will come lead us as we begin to worship in song. Lord God, I thank you for those that said yes to you to go to Montana. And I pray your blessing and favor be upon them. Allow them to see great fruit from their labor. Allow them to see souls saved. Allow them to see people reached and brought into the church there. I pray, Lord God, that you would put a hedge of protection around our team, that you would bind the devil and allow them to have the blessing of being there and again to see fruit from their work. I pray you would bring them back home safely and healthy. And Lord, I thank you for the privilege we have to go. And I thank you for these that said yes to that call. Lord God, as we now lift our voices in praise to you through song, would you be pleased, for you are worthy of all honor and praise. And I pray this all in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Thank you. then what could stand against? Let's sing it, church. Our God is greater.
Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power.
I love Father's Day. I have the privilege of being a father, and I do not take that for granted. And I told our worship ministry already a few times this morning. I don't talk about it very much because I get weepy on Father's Day. I think I've already cried three times this morning. But it's a special day because we're reminded of what the Lord's given us. Not only with my babies, my two beautiful girls, but with my dad, and have a great example in my dad, and I'll be sure to call and tell him that today. And I know my dad would tell you he's not perfect, but I will tell you my dad has tried his hardest to look like Christ. And I was reminded of Ephesians chapter 4 this morning that says, be imitators of Christ. I was reminded of my dad and his striving to do that in his life. But in all of that, as I remember my responsibility and my dad's responsibility, I always remember that I have a heavenly Father. And as Pastor Derek said this morning, that there are some that unfortunately don't have the example of a father or someone that they are able to celebrate on Father's Day. And I've been so encouraged over my lifetime to see those that may not have that, but they take so much joy in the Heavenly Father. They take so much joy in celebrating Him. And today I do celebrate my dad, but I celebrate my Heavenly Father most, because I am who I am because He is who He is. And He did exactly what He said He would do. And He's kept every promise that He set out. And we read this morning in our life group that He told Joshua, Joshua, I will never fail you and I will never forsake you. And that has rung true in my life each and every day. And so this morning, as we celebrate our dads, I do not want to overshadow the fact that we celebrate our Heavenly Father. And He is a good, good Father. And He's perfect in all of His ways. And He's given us a perfect example to follow as we strive to be a good dad and a good father to our families and to those over which we have influence as well. So over these next few moments, as we sing this song, I want you to reflect on the goodness of the Father. Reflect on the fact that He has never failed you. He's never forsaking you, and we have salvation in Him because He keeps His promises, and He is exactly who He says He is. So let's continue to lift our voices this morning and celebrate the good, good Father that we have.
I've heard a thousand stories of what they think your life, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good love. To you are, to you are, to you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am. Oh, and I see many searching for answers far and wide, but I know we're all searching for answers. Only you provide, 'cause you know.
To my ass again, you're a good, good father.
Can't be perfect. We can't be perfect in all the ways that we try, but Lord, we have a perfect example. And Lord, I know it's Father's Day, but I pray over every father, mother, grandparent, mentor, aunt, uncle, Lord, anyone that has an area of influence, that Lord, we would follow your perfect example. Follow the good Father, because you're worthy of following. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And we are loved by you. It's who I am. Who I am, it's who I am. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Tim and worship team. If you haven't figured out, you are loved. Regardless of where you've come from, regardless of what you've gone through or are going through, you have a Father in heaven that loves you unconditionally, that sees you of great value to him. You have a good, good Father. I'm going to invite you to take your Bible and turn with me to Galatians 3. If you're visiting with us, we've been going through this book for multiple weeks now, verse by verse, and we've made our way to chapter 3. We'll be looking at verses 6 through 14 this morning. And just as you're turning there, you don't have to ask me after, and I'm so delighted when people do because they notice, but my wife is not in the room. She is in the nursery, okay? So she's not sick. She's not out of town. She is volunteering her time and energy in the nursery. And as a husband and a father, I'm honored by that. I love having a wife that serves the Lord. She taught the kids this last week in Vacation Bible School, and this morning she is serving the Lord in the nursery. And so that's where she's at, and so thank you for asking, all right? And we're now in Galatians chapter 3. The title of the message today is the argument number two, the scriptural argument. Argument number two, the scriptural argument. Last week, we were reminded by the Apostle Paul, who writes this letter to the Christians in the region of Galatia, that they had experienced salvation by grace through faith and not by works, not by obedience to the law. And so he reminded them of the experiential argument of how we are saved. See, we can be saved by grace through faith, and then people come into our lives and say, yeah, that's nice and that's fine, but you also got to do this, you also got to do that. And the Galatian believers had been led astray by that. And so Paul writes to them to correct that and to get them back on the path of telling the truth regarding the gospel, that we're not saved by works, we're not saved by law, we're saved by grace through faith. Today we look at the second argument. And the second argument is the scriptural argument. In the text today, you're going to find six references to the Old Testament. Every time you see letters in all capitals, that's a quote, a reference from the Old Testament used in the New. And so you're going to see that salvation was by grace through faith in the Old Testament, just as salvation is by grace through faith today. It has never been by the law at any point. No one has ever been, it's never been designed for anyone to be saved by obeying the law of God. It's people are saved by grace through faith. And that's one of the reasons you can read in Hebrews, New Testament book, chapter 11, and see all the Old Testament saints. And it says by faith, by faith, by faith, by faith, because people have always been saved by faith and not by works. And so today we get to see these quotes. If you have found Galatians chapter 3, verse 6, please join with me in standing for the reading of God's word. Beginning in verse 6, even so Abraham believed God, and he was reckoned to him as righteousness. Therefore be sure that it is those who are of faith who are sons of Abraham. The scripture, foreseeing that God would justify the Gentiles by faith, preached the gospel beforehand to Abraham, saying, all the nations will be blessed in you. So then those who are of faith are blessed with Abraham the believer. For as many as are the works of the law are under the curse. For it is written, cursed is everyone who does not abide by all things written in the book of the law to perform them. Now that no one is justified by the law before God is evident, for the righteous shall live by faith. However, the law is not of faith. On the contrary, he who practices them shall live by them. Verse 13, Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law, having become a curse for us, for it is written, cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree. In order that in Christ Jesus, the blessing of Abraham might come to the Gentiles, so that we would receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. Lord, we thank you for your all-powerful, perfect word. We thank you that it's living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword. We thank you that it never returns void. And so we ask, Lord God, that you would bring these verses to life in our minds and hearts and help us to never be the same. Oh, Holy Spirit, do a work in us today that leads to a work through us as well. This is our prayer, and we pray it all in the name of Jesus. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated. I'm going to ask five questions in this message. Number one, how was Abraham saved? How was Abraham saved? Some Christians, again, are confused about people being saved one way in the Old Testament, then another way in the New Testament, because those in the Old Testament lived before Jesus died on the cross. But that's not the case. Abraham was saved by faith, just as we today are saved by faith. He looked forward to the cross and the payment for his sin, as we look back to the cross and the payment of our sin. So let's look now at the example of Abraham. First, Abraham believed. Verse 6, even so Abraham believed God. The word believed, that's faith. He believed God and it was reckoned to him as righteousness. How did Abraham become righteous? By believing in God. Now, this is a quote from Genesis chapter 15, verse 6. Right off the bat, Paul here is quoting from the very first book of the Bible, because he knew the Jews from Jerusalem that had come to the churches in Galatia and had begun to add to the gospel, hey, yes, believe in Jesus, you've got to do that, but you also have to become a Jew. You have to follow our laws. You have to do these works in order to be saved. He knew that they held high Abraham. They knew that they looked to Abraham as the father of the faith, as the father of their practices, as their example, that they are descendants of Abraham, and they took great pride in that. So Paul addresses that by saying, hey, wait a second, you hold high Abraham. Was Abraham saved by the law? And his answer, and the answer is no. See, the Jews were right. The Hebrew people, the Jews, same group of people, the Israelites, all those are the same group of people. They were right that God had chosen them as a select group of people and called them out and gave them the law so they would be separate from all the other nations and how they lived and how they governed themselves, and they would be examples of worshiping God correctly. But they were wrong to believe that each individual among them was going to heaven simply because they were born a Jew, a Hebrew. That was not the case. In order for each of them to go to heaven, they had to believe in the Lord God. They had to place faith in God and not in self. Abraham did that. He is the father of the Hebrew people, and he did that. He believed, and he was reckoned as righteous through that. Salvation was by faith in the days of Abraham. Now, Abraham lived 600 years or so before God gave the Ten Commandments and the first five books of the Bible called the Law to Moses. Now, let me rephrase that. The first five books were written, we believe, by Moses, but obviously God gave him inspiration to write the book of Genesis that happened long before him, okay? And so what we're reading in Genesis about Abraham occurred about 600 years before God gave the Ten Commandments and led Moses, we believe, to write down the first five books of the Bible. And so here we have Abraham believing by faith and being saved by faith 600 years before God gave the law that these Jews had come into Galatia saying, hey, you've got to believe in that too. And Paul's arguing, no, you don't. If you had to believe in the law, Abraham would not be saved. And at that point, they have to go, ooh, he just trapped us. Because they talked about how they were descendants of Abraham, and Abraham would not have been saved if it was by the law. No one before the law would be saved if it was by the law. Second, I want you to see that not only did Abraham believe, but Abraham heard the gospel before believing the gospel. Verse 8. The scripture foreseeing that God would justify Gentiles by faith preached the gospel beforehand to Abraham, saying, all the nations will be blessed in you. Now, notice the last phrase right there. It's a quote from Genesis 18, verse 18. And here we learn that not only are the Hebrew people going to be chosen, that not only are they going to be saved by faith, they're going to, people that are Gentiles like you and I can be saved by faith. It's not just the Jews that God's going to save, but it's also the Gentiles. All the nations, not one nation, all the nations are going to be blessed through Abraham. How so? By faith. You see, the Hebrew people are descendants of Abraham by blood. I'm a Gentile. I'm not a descendant of Abraham by blood. But more important than that, I'm a descendant of Abraham by faith. And that's what Paul's emphasizing here, is faith supersedes blood. Get that. Faith supersedes blood. Now, before Abraham believed, you might be saying he lived 1,800 to 2,000 years before the time of Jesus. How in the world did he hear the gospel 2,000 years before Jesus died? God took the gospel to him and told him, I'm going to send forth the Savior. He's going to live a sinless life. He's going to die on the cross. He's going to pay for people's sin. He's going to pay for your sin. On the third day, he's going to resurrect from the dead. Abraham believed, and it was reckoned to him as righteousness. Notice what it says. I'm not making this up. The scripture, foreseeing that God would justify the Gentiles by faith. Just as he justifies Jews by faith, he'll justify the Gentiles by faith. That has now come to pass. He preached what? The gospel beforehand to who? To Abraham. Saying all the nations will be blessed in you. Abraham heard the gospel before he believed the gospel. He heard of the Savior paying for his sin before he believed in the Savior paying for his sin. Then in the New Testament, we see exactly the same message in Romans chapter 10, verses 14 through 17. It says, "How then will they call on him whom they have not believed?" And check this out. How will they believe in him whom they have not heard? How will they believe in whom they have not heard? Verse 17, so faith comes from hearing and hearing by the word of Christ. In order for someone to believe in the Lord Jesus and be saved, they have to hear of the Lord Jesus. They have to hear the gospel. Please hear me, church. This is why you can never say, we just need to stay home and win the people in our local area. Because there's millions that have never heard. And we're called to go to them. Go make disciples of all nations, he told the disciples with him. And we're descendants of them. We have the same calling as them. We're to be partners with them in their legacy of taking the gospel to the ends of the earth. That's why we go to Guatemala. That's why we go to Montana. That's why we've got to go to the ends of the earth. Because if people don't hear the gospel, they can't believe the gospel. Even Abraham did not believe until he heard. In Acts chapter 8, we see the same thing with the Ethiopian eunuch. He wanted to be saved. He didn't understand. And so God sent Philip to him. And Philip says, do you understand what you're reading from Isaiah? He says, how can I unless someone explains it to me? And Philip shared the gospel with him from the Old Testament book of Isaiah. And the man, the eunuch, was saved. The man was saved after he heard the gospel. Abraham was saved by believing in what he had heard. Number two, how does one become a child of Abraham, a descendant of Abraham? The Jews prided themselves on being descendants of Abraham, but the true descendant of Abraham are those who believe. Verse 7 says, therefore, be sure that it is those who are of faith who are sons of Abraham. Verse 9, so then those who are of faith are blessed with Abraham, the believer. You want to be a descendant of Abraham? You want to be under the blessing of Abraham that God gave to Abraham, where he said all the families of the earth will be blessed, all the nations will be blessed through you? You want to be a part of that blessing? Place your faith in Jesus Christ. And you become a descendant of Abraham by faith. You get adopted into the family of God by faith. Faith supersedes blood. Number three, what does the law do? Verse 10 and through 12 says, for as many as are the works of the law are under a curse. For it is written, cursed is everyone who does not abide by all things written in the book of the law to perform them. Now that right there is a quote from Deuteronomy 27, verse 36. Verse 11, now that no one is justified by the law before God is evident, for the righteous man shall live by faith. That is a quote from Habakkuk 2:4. Verse 12, however, the law is not of faith. On the contrary, he who practices them shall live by them. That's a quote from Leviticus 18:5. Right here, we have three Old Testament quotes that apply to the New Testament Christian. Are y'all with me? It's not that the Old Testament is not for you and me. Yes, it is for you and me. It is just as much for you and me today as ever. And here he gives three quotes to show it. Now let's take a look at these. He shares that no one's ever been justified by the law. Notice verse 10, cursed is everyone who does not abide by all the things written in the book of the law. What's the book of the law? The first five books of the Bible. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. There's not a person on planet earth other than Jesus that has ever upheld all that's written in that perfectly. No one. And therefore, the law doesn't save, the law condemns, the law leaves us guilty. That's why he says everyone's cursed. Verse 11, now that no one is justified by the law before God, that's why, because we're all guilty. But the righteous doesn't live trying to uphold the law, the righteous lives by faith. The law represents man's effort to earn righteousness. That's how the Jews were using it. Obey the law, that's how you get right with God. That's how you are saved. And Paul is saying, no, 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 you're saved by grace through faith, not by works, so that no one can boast. H.A. Ironside was sharing the gospel on the streets of a California city. And he would go up to people and he would say, he would start a conversation with them, and they say, "How can we know that you're right when there's so many religions in the world?" And he said, "What do you mean there's so many religions in the world?" They said, "There's hundreds." He says, "No, I only know of two." They said, "What do you mean there's only two?" He said, "Well, there's the religion that says you try to earn your own way and you can save yourself by your works and your effort. Or there's the way that says you can't save yourself, therefore you need someone else to save you by what he has done." They go, "Okay." You see, all religions, whether it's Hindus, Buddhist, Muslim, Jehovah's Witness, it doesn't matter if it's a cult, doesn't matter if it's called a religion, it doesn't matter what it's called. If it's not biblical Christianity, I haven't found another one where people realize I can't save myself and it's through what Jesus has already done for me. All of the religions are man trying to work their way to God, trying to earn God's righteousness. The Jews do it, the Muslims do it. The Buddhist does it, the Hindu does it. Biblical Christianity realizes I cannot save myself, so I turn to the Savior who gave his life for me, Jesus. There's really only two religions out there. So I need to ask you right now before we continue, do you believe you can save yourself? Do you believe that being here today is going to help you into heaven just by being in the room? Are you here to try to get God to do something for you? Or are you here because of what he's already done for you? What's your motive? Do you think you can save yourself, or do you realize you need another to save you? Paul's emphasizing that anyone who thinks that works will save is actually cursed, because no one can abide by all the things written in the book of the law. No one is justified by the law. Righteousness comes by faith, just like it did for Abraham. Abraham believed and it was reckoned to him as righteousness. Salvation's a gift. Salvation's by grace through faith. Ephesians 2:8-9 says this: "For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not of yourselves." It's a gift, the gift of God. Not as a result of your works, so that none of us, no one, may boast. Instead of saving us, the law condemns us. The law places us under the curse. The law reveals our guilt. So now, number four, and we're doing pretty good, right? I mean, we've covered three of the five already. All right. Number four, what does the curse reveal? I want to give you a few truths regarding this curse. The curse of sin upon you is God's displeasure. God does not approve of sin. He does not condone sin. He does not justify sin. When Adam and Eve ate of the fruit in the Garden of Eden, sin entered the world, and now we are all under that curse. We're born under that curse. We have an inclination to sin. We have an inclination to do wrong rather than right. We have an inclination to be selfish rather than selfless. We have an inclination to be prideful and think of self rather than think of the Lord, and therefore think of others. And the curse is God's displeasure with that. You say, "I thought God is loving. I thought he's a good father." Yes, he is, and therefore he's a just father. He's a loving father. He's a just father. He encourages us when we're down, and he picks us up. When we are weak, he is strong. He also humbles us when we're prideful. That's what a good, good father does. He loves us so much, he doesn't say, "Hey, you go ahead in your sin. I don't care." Yes, he does care. And he says, "I love you so much that I care about your sin so much that I gave my life for you." That's what God the Son did. Father sent his Son, and the Son gave his life for us. That's how much the Father loves you, but it's also how serious he takes sin. See, please hear me. In our day, there's a growing trend that love means you condone. God does not condone your sin. He doesn't say it doesn't matter. He says it matters so much to me that my son has to bleed and die. But you mean so much to me that I'm sending him to do so. There's no greater message of love, but there's also no greater message of justice than God the Father sending God the Son to pay the price for our sin. Please don't be one that winks at sin, condones sin, justifies sin. Well, so-and-so did this, I can do this in response. No, you can't. God's called you to holiness. Don't justify what he hates. The curse is a sign of his displeasure. Second, the curse is a sign of his judgment. God brought the curse on sin, and God is completely holy and righteous. And so we can't get into heaven simply because God is love. There had to be justice. There had to be a payment for the sin. There had to be a judgment. You say, hey, I get to go to heaven. It costs me nothing. Yeah, it costs you nothing. It costs God his son. It costs a whole lot. The curse is a sign of his judgment against sin. The curse also reveals our separation from God. There's a great chasm between God and the sinner. And no amount of good can make that connect and unite you with God. It is only through Jesus, who knew no sin, becoming your sin, and you placing faith in him, can you be reconciled with God. Abraham didn't tell God how good he was. Moses didn't tell God how good he was. They believed on the Lord God and were saved. And the same is true today. We are saved by grace through faith. God is a God of love. He's also a God of justice. He's a God that will honor his character and never compromise it. So we've asked the questions. How was Abraham saved? How does one become a child of Abraham? What does the law do? What does the curse reveal? And now number five, what did Christ do for us? Verse 13, Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law. Hallelujah! Amen? Having become a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree. So according to verse 13, Jesus did two things. First, he redeemed us. The word redeemed means set free by payment. He didn't just set us free. He doesn't just save us. He saves us by paying the fine, paying the debt, which is his death upon the cross. He had to give his life to pay for your salvation, to rescue you from your sin. But he set you free. He redeemed us. He pays the price. He pays the fine to set us free. There was a young man that went to a pastor under great distress, and he said to the minister, how can I find peace? And then he said this, what must I do to find peace? And the pastor said, oh, young man, you're too late. He says, too late? You mean I'm too late to be saved? The pastor, no. No, you're not too late to be saved. You're just too late to do something about it. Jesus has already done it. It's receiving what he's done. It's placing your faith in the one that gave his life and rose from the dead on the third day. Jesus has already done it 2,000 years ago. It's too late for you to do anything but receive what he's done. It is finished. He has redeemed us. God is gracious, but he's not so gracious to overlook our sin. He paid for the sin. And now, because he paid for the sin, you who have believed on the Lord Jesus, may you be encouraged, because you have been purchased. You have been set free. When you believe on the Lord Jesus, what he did for you on the cross is applied to you, and you are forgiven. You are made new. You are his. You are forgiven. The weight of sin is gone. Redeemed. Oh, how I love to proclaim it. Redeemed. How? By the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed through his infinite mercy, his child, and forever I am. Redeemed, redeemed. Redeemed by what? The blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, redeemed. His child, forever I am. I hope you can sing that song today, because he has redeemed you. He has saved your soul. The second thing he did for us, he redeemed us, but second, he became the curse. We're under the curse as sinners. He became the curse. Verse 13, Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law, having become a curse for us. He didn't do it for himself. He did it for us. Christ himself is spotless, without blemish. He's perfect and pure. No sinful thought ever came through his mind as he walked this earth. No, nothing of his flesh was ever wrong in what he did. Nothing in what he thought was wrong. Nothing in what he believed was wrong. No evil ever sprang from his soul or spirit. And he took your place and my place, and he took our punishment. He who knew no sin became sin. He became the curse for us. What a message of love we have. He says in verse 13, having become a curse for us, for it is written, cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree. Here we have another quote from the Old Testament. Deuteronomy 21, 23 is where that comes from. See, the Jewish people in the time of Deuteronomy, in the time of Moses, they did not crucify people. There was no one that they put on a tree, that they nailed to a tree, that they nailed to a cross. That didn't happen. What they did to kill people in those days was stone them. And so what is it talking about here? It's talking about Jesus becoming the curse for them 1,400 years later, as he was nailed to the tree. Now, here's what's significant. In the time of Moses, they didn't nail people to a tree, but they did hang people from a tree. Why would they take the dead and put them up for the public to see? Because it was a warning. If you live in rebellion to God, then here is the result. It was a deterrent for more crime. It was an embarrassment, right, to be stoned and then left hanging there for all to see. It was a curse. And Jesus now has given his life, not in private, not in a way that's not recorded, but out in the public. He was shamed. He was treated as a criminal. He was degraded. He died an embarrassing, humiliating death. He died the death that the worst of the culture died. But he did it even though he had never sinned. He fulfilled this. Cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree. He took the curse and the shame and the guilt of my sin and yours. Look, I know you don't feel real good about yourself at the moment with this, but I hope you sure do feel good about what Jesus has done for you. You ought to feel real good about Jesus and what he's done for you. He took the public shame. He took your selfishness and your pride, your laziness and your evil intentions. And he took them and placed them on himself and bore the curse to deliver you, to redeem you, to set you free. Now last, Why did Christ become the curse? Verse 14, in order that in Christ Jesus the blessing of Abraham might come to the Gentiles. Now remember, God promised through Abraham all the nations are going to be blessed through you. The families of the earth are going to be blessed through you. How? Through faith in the same God as Abraham. Okay? And now what does it say? He died as the curse so that the blessing of Abraham from 2,000 years before would be put on the Gentiles who placed their faith in Jesus Christ. This is good stuff. I stand before you as a Gentile. I'm so grateful Jesus went to the cross so that I could receive the blessing of Abraham. And then he says, so that we would receive the promise of the Spirit. How do you receive the Spirit of God? Through faith in God the Son. He bore the curse that was not his for us not to bear the curse that was ours. He died to redeem, to save that which was lost. He died as the curse so that we could receive the Spirit by faith. 2 Corinthians 5:21, he made him who knew no sin to be sin on our behalf so that we might become the righteousness of God in him. Now, what did it say about Abraham? He believed God and it was reckoned to him as righteousness. Jesus died that we could receive that same righteousness. Here's the reality. Each of us either live under the curse or we live under the forgiveness and grace of God who took the curse on him. Where do you land today? Are you under the curse that separates you from God? Are you under the curse that leaves you where you cannot save yourself? No amount of effort and work will do. Are you living under the curse that provides no hope? Or are you under the redemption of Jesus Christ that sets you free? Are you under the redemption that declares you innocent? Are you under the redemption that provides you everlasting life and places God's righteousness on you? Which one are you? If you'll bow your heads and close your eyes, please. No one moving around. This is a very important time. Allow God to do a work here. I want to ask you a question. Do you know that if you died today, you'd spend eternity with Jesus? And if so, how do you know that? Have you believed, or are you trusting in your effort, in your works, in your reputation, in your profession? Or are you trusting in what Jesus has done for you and your faith in him? Have you been saved? God knows your heart. He knows you can trick me, you can trick others, but do you know Jesus? Are you saved? Are you on the way to heaven? Have you been forgiven? Have you been redeemed from the curse of the law? If not, place your faith in Jesus. Believe in him. Trust in him, not in self. Confess Jesus as your Lord, your master, your boss. Believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead on the third day, and you will be saved from your sin. You will be rescued from the curse. Right where you're sitting right now, you can call on the name of Jesus and be saved. To all believers, have you been taking your salvation for granted? Have you been adding works to your salvation? Have you been adding works in order to find your self-esteem in Jesus, or are you resting in what Jesus has done for you and his love for you? If you've been resting in your works, then confess that as sin. Repent and walk in holiness with the Lord Jesus. Holy Spirit, stir the hearts of the saved to repent, to not add to your gospel. And Lord God, move on the hearts of those who need you right now to call on you to save their souls. This is our prayer, and we pray it in the name of Jesus. Amen.